going back, nor the wind stopping in where the valley's in flame and in his room. My grandfather told me that it shouldn't be blind. No question is here, and I'm proud of you. Early morning rises and the dingoes are howling, the flowers are blooming, you can smell the perfume. I can see the rainbow and it's calling for me, where the world up and I'm going back, all the way to the where the palace is plain, and the Emmy's wrong. My grandfather told me that it shouldn't be blind. Your culture is here, I'm proud of you. Early morning rises, and the dingoes are howling.
Hi, welcome to Barclay Regional Arts in Tennant Creek in the Northern Territory. I'm Kathy Burns, the Artistic Director for the organisation, and today I'll be your host. You're tuning into an event for Anti-Poverty Week called exStreamheArt. It's a partnership between the National Rural Health Alliance and Barclay Regional Arts. Today I'll be taking you on a virtual tour of Barclay Arts, introducing you to our employees and showing you some of the range of works we've been doing for the past year. But before that, I'd like to give you a bit of a context for the region in which we work and live. Tennant Creek is known as the Golden Heart of the Northern Territory, a reference to its booming mining days of the 1930s. Located 598 kilometres north of Alice Springs and 988 kilometres south of Darwin, we are literally in the middle of the Northern Territory. The Barclay is extreme. Extreme heat, dryness, remoteness, disengagement, extreme ubiquitous dysfunction in people's lives, in organisations, in communities, intergenerational trauma and grief and despondency for many verging on despair. But on the flip side, extreme cultural richness and diversity, beauty of the landscape, connection to the land and each other, generosity of spirit and a longing to walk comfortably in two worlds. The Barclay region of the Northern Territory covers 323,514 square kilometres, 42% larger than the state of Victoria. Barclay's estimated population is 8,137. Approximately 70% of the population is Indigenous, with 25% aged less than 17 years. 16 language groups reside in the region, and English is frequently a third or a fourth language. And across the region, different language groups live together. There are 11 language groups in Tennant Creek alone, and various regional economies have been responsible for language groups being displaced and moved together in other areas. These collocations continue to cause tensions and conflict in communities across the region. And fighting between families is common, often fueled by alcohol. Tennant Creek has the highest alcohol consumption in the world, and domestic violence is 120 times more than the national average. But the community has been working hard on lowering these figures. The Barclay's health status is also pretty shocking. For example, it has the highest level of kidney disease in the world, and remoteness worsens the impact of this. Many children are hearing impaired, and this affects learning across the board. Mental health is also problematic, with the highest suicide rate in Australia. These factors seriously affect people's ability to work and limits their quality of life. The new cultural fabric of the region is infinitely complex and ancient, For example, in many communities, Christianity coexists with traditional rites of passage and traditional law. Spearing or breaking a leg is not an uncommon punishment. However, Western Lao prevails and incarceration and recidivism rates are high. Our workout bush involves a whole range of logistics and careful planning each time. Imagine driving 4 hours out to a community and realizing you have forgotten a vital piece of equipment or that it is broken. It means we have to be resourceful. Driving to these communities can be dangerous. The roads are windy and dusty and unsealed. And if it rains, forget about driving or being able to get back as the road will turn to mud. If we break down or have an accident, let's hope the satellite phone works. We travel in teams from 2 people up to 14, depending on the project, which means our accommodation is usually a swag under the stars, an outdoor kitchen with no ability to keep food cold, and access to a bathroom and shower will hopefully through the schools. So our team are resilient and adventurers. We love what we do and the people we work with, and we think our end results are great. All of these layers and many more comprise the context in which Barclay Regional Arts works. So, now more about what Barclay Regional Arts does. We have 7 programs in Barclay Regional Arts, which are the Wananjikari Music Centre, Visual Arts Outreach, Media Mob, Youth Arts, Touring and Events, ACCC Radio and the Desert Harmony Festival. And I'll tell you more about each of these programs as we move through the virtual tour, 1 program at a time. We have 19 employees at BRA, 14 of which are Indigenous, and our mission is to provide quality arts opportunities for all people in all communities across the Barclay. And we do this through exemplary community engagement and the creation of collaborative platforms for unique artistic cultural expression. We've also got a focus on creating cultural enterprise and communications and information, allowing access and participation for Indigenous people to have a platform to share their voice, community and work to the greater Australia. So that's a bit about what we do. So let's start our virtual tour, and we're going to start with the Wananjikari Music Centre, which is our most advanced program. Also, one thing I want to say is remember that today is an interactive experience, so if you have questions, please Twitter them in. We have a Twitter at @Barclay_arts, and we'll answer all questions at the end of today as well. Also, if you're having difficulties with the stream, on your player, you'll have a little cogwheel. You can also click that and you can reduce the quality depending on if you're having dropouts or not on your end as well. Okay, so the Wananjikari Music Centre, well, it operates as a music production house and training centre for Indigenous musicians and music production technicians. The vision of WMC is to use contemporary and traditional forms of cultural expression through music to address ongoing challenges and barriers experienced by Indigenous communities. WMC is an innovative example of using creative cultural expression to address issues in relation to cultural maintenance, unemployment, education, training, health, and community well-being. On-site, we have 2 recording studios, a rehearsal space with equipment, and all the production resources, including staging, lighting, sound, remote recording gear. We have skilled men that can actually run major events in the Northern Territory. And WMC employs 8 Indigenous men. So I'll hand it over to music manager James Winwood and WMC musician Brendan Hines, who are going to take you on a virtual tour of WMC.
Hello and welcome. I'm Brendan Hines.
And I'm James Winwood, and we're from the Wananjikari Music Centre here in Tennant Creek. We are currently in Studio B here. It's a small little studio. You'll see the rest of the place shortly, but we thought we'd start here. It's a small little room that we've managed to soundproof and just equip with sources that we've found from around the community to make it sound a little better for recording in and mixing, which is exactly what young Joseph's here doing. How are you, Joseph?
Good.
That's the way. And what have you got? What have you been working on?
A new song, yeah.
Uh-huh. Give us a little demo. Nice work, mate. Sounds good. We might leave Joseph to it and continue the tour. I'll show you the rest of the place. So Wananjikari has been around for almost 10 years now. It's we employ 7 guys here and do training and recording and all aspects of music production. Brendan's been here for probably one of the longest.
This is the hall. Wananjikari means singing for belonging. And this hall, it was just a hall before, and now I'm like, we've got shelves here too as well, and the cables up there on the wall. And this is old Leslie Thompson. He's been here since 4 or 5 years, I think. And this are the band equipment. And we've got the drums here. And we're gonna show you, this is Dirk.
Hello.
He's our sound mixer.
Yep, I do sound for the fellas.
We also do our live gigs.
This is usually our gear we take out on the road. It's a big part of what we do is recording and live stuff. So we've got a remote portable rig that we can take out bush with us to record in communities. It's often very hard to get bands to come in to us because of many reasons. Mm. So we often head out there and record there. So we do a lot of practice here. And we have a wall of speakers, which you'll see in a film clip very shortly, that are in various states of repair. But we'll come and have a look at the main recording studio.
This is the main recording studio. This is Studio A. And we've got Brian here. And there's Reggie up there on the drums. And this is where we also I'm going to do recording too as well.
So we sort of, most of these guys are training in not just playing, but also recording and live sound, repairing cables, soldering cables, pretty much all aspects of putting on a live show or recording, because there's not much out here. So if we want to do anything to do with music, we kind of have to do it all ourselves.
Yep.
So that's basically what Wunundjikari is, and we have these guys here every day, and then many people come from different communities and different musicians come and practice and play here as well. But all this in this recording room gets played here, and it all runs through cables into this main recording studio here, so we might pop in and have a bit of a look at what Marcus is up to.
Show you. This is where it all happens.
Good morning, Marcus. How are you?
Oh, pretty good. Yourself?
Very well.
We're very good.
Yeah, this is where we normally do our recordings. At the moment, I'm recording Reg on the drums for our latest album, The Barkley Boys' Freedom Road. Clips. And this one's, we did a few months back. This one's called Dark Night by The Barkley Boys. Hope you enjoy.
We'll be right back.
pretty much loved that film clip, don't we? It's a good one. We're going to take some time now with WMC just so you guys can hear from the team about their work that they do here. And I might start with you, Reggie. I'm going to take that. And do you want to just tell us what kind of work it is here that you do at WMC?
We do mixing and learn how to do Pro Tools. And yeah, we learn how to do lightings. I do the lightings now, and it's pretty good for me here to work at WMC and work with these fellas. They're really good, and learn a lot from these fellas, you know. And yeah, we've done a video clip, so yeah, that's really good.
And Dirk, for you in particular, you've done a lot of the training this year. Do you want to just talk a little bit about all the different skills that you've picked up?
I started back in 2011 working here, and when I first started there, I didn't know anything about what's going on around here. So I had to ask people, you know, what to do, and yeah, then how to do like working stuff around here, like in music. So for the past years, I know how to fix cables, like do soldering and that, and do sound, live sound. I even do sound for the fellas, yeah, and recording.
Yeah. Dirk in particular has done really, really well for the last little while of getting really trained up and taking things really quickly on board. And he's an excellent member of our team. What we want to show you before we talk a little bit further is 2 years ago, we have a mobile recording unit that the fellas go out to community so they can record bands. We went out to a community that's about 3.5 hours away called Epinara, and we recorded an album there. It was a Christmas and gospel album for that community. We then went back and we did a live album launch. We also webcasted events so that people from all around the world could actually tune in and see that live album launch. So we want to show you a little bit of that.
The next song we're going to sing is Father, Father, again, again.
That was a pretty fantastic event, and what made it even more incredible was the women were involved in that event. It showed a whole range of musicians. You can actually see the whole scope of that clip if you go to our Vimeo channel. You can watch the whole collection, but we wanted to show you that in particular because the women singing the gospel was a really significant part of that project. And funnily enough, a market that came out of that, Christian bookstores in particular, really wanted copies of that CD, which then sold in those bookstores. So a market we didn't even think about popped up, and so obviously profits from those CDs go all back to that community. And last year in particular, they had a huge Christmas party in the community of Epinara last year, which was really a really nice outcome. But I want to talk now to Brendan Hines. Brendan's been with us for a while, and Brendan, you've got an interesting way of how you first came to WMC. Do you want to tell them a little bit about that?
I tried. I'm like jobs after jobs, but I didn't like what I was doing.
And then I heard of Unanjikari Music Center. And then I thought, this is just for me. And I love playing music. And it's to make everybody feel happy. And I love writing down songs. Yeah, that's it.
Yeah, beautiful. Thank you. And James, I might cut to you. James is our music manager of the Wananjikari Music Centre. Do you want to just tell us some of the highs and lows that you guys as a team go through and challenges and how you guys work through challenges?
Sure. Well, it's a pretty unique and amazing part of the country that we're lucky enough to work in. But a big part of the challenge is just how remote we are. Yeah. We're a long way from most service centres, and particularly working in music, quite unique equipment and and stuff that we need to use and supplies and maintenance, and a lot of music equipment's very sort of sensitive, delicate and expensive gear. So getting that stuff repaired and sent out, everything's a lot more expensive for us out here, and particularly when we're out bush and on the road, dust is a constant factor, and just wear and tear is, the lifespan of a lot of our equipment is half of what it would be in a city. Just because of the wear and tear and the beating that it cops on these dusty roads and in the back of a trailer and four-wheel drives, droopies. So I guess that's a bit of a challenge for us, just the remoteness and getting people to out here. But it's also part of the charm, and it's one of the very special things we have out here is some of those concerts that we're putting on in communities that aren't getting much music or much opportunity to see live music at all. So when we're out there putting on these shows, the appreciation and the communities really come alive, and that makes it really special to be a part of. It's not easy, and it's very hot and dry and dusty out here. Mm-hmm. There can be sort of trying conditions, and especially this time of year as we move into summer, it really takes on a life of its own. Gets very, very hot, 40 yeah. degrees every single day. Yeah. So we do work under the elements a little bit, it's also really rewarding having overcoming those challenges and making shows happen like we do, and the guys all pitching in. Yeah. A really good team. And they understand that we need to work as a team to succeed, and we do a really good job.
Yeah, and I have to say that our Wananjikari Music Centre team, you guys are highly, highly skilled, and we do a lot of events all around the territory, and I suppose the feedback we get all the time is just how professional the fellas were, and they just got in and did the work, and it's a luxury to have such an incredible team, really highly skilled, so it's a tribute to you guys and the work you do. Thank you. One of the members that we couldn't have here today because he's at school, it's our youngest WMC member. His name is Joseph Shannon. We've actually got an arrangement with Tennant Creek High School in which Joseph spends time here at Wananjikari Music Centre so we can get trained in music and be employed. And then in the afternoons, he goes off and does his schoolwork. So we've got a really incredible video postcard that Joseph worked together with Media Mob about his story. So I'll let the video talk for itself.
Dear Dad, I'm really loving playing music. I remember those days when you used to sit with me and show me chords when I was. I never knew much then, but now I do. To this present day, I'm still learning a few things. You were my stepping stone to learning music. Music has brought me so far in my life. I've even got a job as a musician at the Wananjikari Music Center. The fellas have been teaching me a lot of new things about music. With these skills and knowledge, I can further my career as a musician and an individual.
Yes, I do miss you and Dad.
With this job, I can provide to my family food and clothes. I even had enough money left over to buy a motorbike.
I told
take a walk in the evening rain. There's still so many people. Don't care if I get soaked.
I can feel. After work at 12 o'clock, I go to school part time for my studies. This way, I get the best of both worlds. I can be a rock star and a student. Saying come to Eric's wall. Yes, it is the sight of all. Yes, I do miss my mom and dad. No, the city is not that bad. Thanks for your support. Maybe one day I can teach my children some things about music. Your son, Joseph.
Hello, welcome. Welcome to the Barclay Arts Studio. I'm Jessica Raitt.
And I'm Rhonda Plummer.
And we run the program, the visual arts program across the Barclay region. We work with around 75 artists across the communities of Moncada, Epinara, Elliot and Canteen Creek. We run a program that supports artists to run their own tin shed small art enterprises in their own communities, assisting arts workers and artists with cataloguing, admin and creative workshops. We visit the communities every few weeks and we bring the artwork back to the community in town in Tennant Creek to sell the work or send it off to galleries around the country.
And over here we've got our own artists that works here. These are the Tadakula artists, and Tadakula means big mob in Walmanpa. So over this way we've got
the workshop,
and that's where we do our stretching of the canvas.
Stretching canvases ready to be made into beautiful artworks.
And on this side we've got where we do our cataloguing for the art center. Our art center is across the Barclay. And we've got, would you like to have a look at our gallery?
We opened up this gallery space about 2 months ago. It took a few months of painting and shelving and cataloguing over 800 artworks to get ready for our own little shop in the middle of Tennant Creek. So when we go out to the communities, we bring work back here to sell. And it's a place where people from town or passing tourists can come in and see the work or buy work from across the Barclay region. And most of the paintings are acrylic on canvas, and you can see here we've got beautiful works with lots of vibrant colours that we keep from across the community. And we've got some wall space for exhibitions when a body of work comes out of a community. We've also got watches. These guys were made at this year's Barclay Artist Camp, where for 1 week we took all the interested artists from across the community to a homestead and had creative workshops, including collage and weaving with raffia and wool. And the artists who learnt these skills have then gone back to their communities and taught other artists and continued to make these beautiful creatures that come back to the shop.
And here we've got a book as well with for the Bush Medicine project that was done at Moncada. That's sharing Bush Medicine and Bush Tucker and within that area and I think within Barclay region as well.
And teaching the kids in the community.
Teaching the kids.
Yeah. And this way.
This way. We've got the Epinara scarves, and that was done at Epinara.
And these were made using natural dyes from leaves and grass, and the patterns are made like a tie-dye technique using rusty old car parts and found objects around the community, like nails or more leaves.
Yes, and on this shelf here, we've got fabrics from the Kulamindi Arts. They printed, hand printed.
Yeah, lino prints.
And yeah. Lino prints from that area with the animals and plants from that area.
So
and
if you'd like to see our new project, we just opened up a ceramics workshop, and we've got a pilot project running where some trainee arts workers have learnt how to, is it called slip casting?
Slip casting.
Yeah.
And how to use the kiln. And I was one of the persons that was taught by one of the
visiting
art worker that came and taught me how to do this, how to do the pottery, the ceramic potteries for this. So this is what come out of it, out of that training. Yeah.
So the bowls and the plates are made here. Is it with the kiln?
With this.
Using molds.
Molds from slip. These ones here.
And the
these molds here, where we do nothing, and
the objects are then taken out to get
painted by the artist, the painter artist, and that's the kiln there that we used to cook the pot, the ceramics. So they've been doing a lot of work with them.
Just in a trial phase. So it's about training arts workers in town how to create the product, and then another opportunity for the artists to share their designs and their creative talent just with a different medium. It's another small business enterprise that we're just testing the waters with at the moment. Yeah. Anyway, thank you very much for visiting.
And we'd like to see you come and see our art centre. Thank you.
Thanks. And before the ladies make their way in, I just want to give a bit of a shout out to those who have been tweeting in. So hi to NITV, the National Health Alliance, and to Bridie Bartlett, one of our partners of Griffith University. So thanks, guys, for tuning in. Thank you for your tweets. And obviously, we'd love to hear from everyone. And don't forget, if you have any questions about anything that comes up, please make sure you Twitter it into us and we'll answer it all at the end. So while the ladies are making their way in, I want to also talk about some other scope of our visual arts unit. Last year, we did a Festivals Australia project, which is a visual arts project. It was called Empower. And our visual arts worker at the time, Justin DeLu, he decided to get old bike parts that were stranded all around community and make these amazing pedal-powered sculptures. So we got all this welding unit, we took it out to community, and he worked with people in community and showed them how to weld and make these amazing sculptures. And we brought them in for the Desert Harmony Festival, and they're interactive, so they did things when you got on and you pedaled them. They did things like made bubbles, you could race cars around a track, you could do paintings off them, they lit up, they did all sorts of amazing things. So we want to quickly show you a documentary about Justin's experience, and also too just Harry Buncher, a particular worker he worked out in Canton Creek. From that project, he then went on to make these incredible sculptures out of reclaimed scrap metal. And they're also now in galleries in Alice Springs and Tilapia Gallery. So it was a really positive outcome for that worker. But here's the doco to tell you more.
Hi, I'm Justin. I work for Barclay Arts. We're working on this pedal powered Empower project that's part of the Desert Harmony Festival this year in the end of August, beginning of September. We're building these pedal powered contraptions that are going to make light and other things work. It's going to be working out on two communities out at Epinara and Canteen Creek with the fellas out there. Chopping up some old bikes, building these contraptions that will run little pedal-powered dynamos. They'll make light. We'll be able to charge phones off of them, iPads, hopefully running these little scale electrics car sets. We'll also have some pedal-powered juices. I'm glad the weather's changed because it gets damn hot here and I've got to gear up in all my safety gear, gloves, leather jacket, you know, mask, helmet, earmuffs, all that kind of thing. So I can look a bit odd wandering around the house in all my safety gear here. They often say I look a bit like Walter from when I'm all geared up. Okay, so this is one of the contraptions we've come up with. It's running from an old exercise bike. Basically, when you pedal, one of these wheels connects up to the next wheel, so on. So we've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 wheels running off of here. We've got two dynamos running off of it, one on either side. They've got 12 volt outputs and a 2.5 volt output, so I can wire up two sets of lights. As soon as I start pedaling, those lights light up. As soon as I stop, they stop.
I guess you get the feeling that you've created the energy.
I've been sourcing bikes as many as I can from different people, different places, through advertising on our Facebook page. I've driven around town, going to the tip and just driving around the bush. Apparently kids will ride out bush, go and muck around, they'll get a puncture or whatever, so they'll dump them out there. Been cruising around on the weekends looking for something to do, get to explore all out the back here, you know, get to see a bit more of Tennant Creek. Oh, hang on, reckon we've got one, it's down there. Another one, no front wheel, but maybe they fixed up another bike out here and then brought this one in. All right, let's see if we can find any more. Okay, so this one's technically, this is our little sort of kinetic spin art machine. Kids will be able to pedal on here. It's all geared up to go quite fast, going through that gear into here, and then that one technically gears onto that, gets that spinning really fast. We'll be attaching a plate sort of system and a bowl and everything on top of here, but kids will be able to whack a piece of paper down on here, little devices up here, squeeze them, paint's gonna squirt out while this is spinning really fast. And come out with this sort of spiral art kind of design. Kids will be able to make them up and have something to take home after Desert Harmony. Remind them about all these things they've jumped on and pedaled away on. A lot of this whole idea for the project started just from my keenness in bikes and building old bikes up and stuff. So a lot of researching on the internet on pedal powered and just bicycle projects around the world. I found this thing called scrapper bikes. these kids in Oakland, California, put gaff tape on the wheels of their bikes, paint them up, all out of just old bikes that they've found lying around, and they call them scrapper bikes. There's scrapper bike gangs of these kids that go on big rides around town, and it's a bit of a empowerment thing, I guess, for young kids, something to do, something to feel proud of. And so that's inspired a little bit of my wanting to get out there, decorate my own bike, see what people think out in the street. Crazy looking bike that lights up when I ride, so I like going out and seeing the reactions that happen. I'm hoping more and end result will actually just a bit more pedal power awareness and get kids riding bikes on communities a bit more. It's a flat town. It's easy to get from one place to another on bikes, and I don't think it's a resource that's used enough. Everybody's a bit too car dependent out here.
I have with me now some of our visual arts team, and we showed you a little bit of our art centre here in Tennant Creek. We've also got art centres that we manage out in community, so I'm going to throw to Jessica to tell us a little bit of the work that we do out in community.
Sure. So we've got one group of artists who work here, but then most of our program is working remote with four other communities: Canteen Creek, Epinara, Coolamandini and Moncada. Mm-hmm. Each of these communities sort of vary in the way they operate. Some are more, I guess they're all grassroots enterprises, but some are more set up as mini art centres. Others are a little bit more like a social art program or, yeah, community art program. So they've got different needs. Yeah. We'll go out every few weeks to each community. We'll help with the day-to-day running of the art centres. Three of these communities have their own employed art centre coordinators. So myself or other arts workers will go out and we'll support with the day-to-day running, such as cataloguing, preparing canvases or mixing colours mm-hmm. for the artists. We'll then sometimes take out professional arts workers, depending on what the community's needs, such as a ceramics worker, someone to train in printmaking, or just to get an exhibition of work ready, a body of work ready for an exhibition.
Yeah.
We also take out all the supplies mm-hmm. because it's remote. And help the communities with their ordering of new paints, new canvases, new tools. And then we'll bring the paintings back into town to sell or send away to galleries. And we'll also link in these arts workers and artists to external training opportunities and also like remote or regional art forums mm-hmm. In Alice Springs and Darwin. And we also support these communities to bring their work to town to sell work at the markets or at city markets as well. So it's supporting with the transport, the logistics of accommodation. Mm. Essentially, this model works so that the communities can have an independent business or program running, and then we support them with how they need to continue their programs. So we're not there on a day-to-day basis, so it's quite an independent model for each community.
Yeah. And you've also been doing something really great, which is the pop-up market system as well, out in community too, so they can actually have a market out in community.
Yeah.
And you did one recently, because we had the Army working with us for a little while, well, not with us, but out in community for a little while. That was a really great market, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was fantastic. Yeah.
Sold a lot of stuff.
Yeah.
It was really good.
It was good. Cleaned out the art centres. Yeah. And that's just a model that can be brought to town or like to Alice Springs as well. So it's training people to sell their own work, have their own little avenue for sales, revenue.
Yeah.
And then, like the more we do these things, the more we can step back and they can run on their own.
Great.
Yeah.
And we have with us Nakamura Susanna Nelson. Nakamura is one of our Tadukala artists, which is based here in Tennant Creek. And I want to get Nakamura to talk to us about some of the paintings. What kind of paintings do you do?
I'm Nakamura. I'm Susan Nakamura. I do a painting, a station, ceremony, culture, smoking baby, Chardogula. Chardogula, the mob, all of us in the big mob's peoples.
And Nakamura is talking about, that's the name of their artist group here in Tennant Creek. It's Tardukala, which means one mob, many mob, lots of people. That was the name that they assigned themselves, so that's really nice. Nakamura's work's really beautiful, and she definitely has a distinct style and been getting a lot of sales of your work, which has been really, really nice. And I want to introduce you to Rhonda as well, and Rhonda's started working with us. So might Rhonda, just tell us a little bit about how you like working here and how you enjoy your work and...
Yeah, I enjoy working at the Art Center with the artists, going out to the communities and helping a lot of artists out there as well. I'm doing a lot of cataloging with the artwork and learning a lot of other new stuff that I'm involved with working in the Art Center.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's really interesting work and I really enjoy it.
Yeah, and Rhonda came on with us at a really busy time. It was right during our Desert Harmony Festival. So, yeah, you came right in the crux of when we were really working full on, weren't we?
Yes, came in and helped with because I got that bit of experience working with Yolali Curry Arts.
Mm.
So, yeah, so I come in and help and end up staying here working with the artists.
Yeah,
yes,
that's so great.
We've got a really good, cool team working together. So it's the same group that I work with at Yolali Curry Arts.
So the visual arts team's really, it's a really nice cohesive little team and the ladies have set up their studio, you know, you've got your own music playing in there and all the ladies select their music so they can paint away in the studio and make it nice and relaxed and comfortable. So it's really good.
Yes.
Yeah, it's really nice. Mm. And Jess, I might talk about... We haven't got Lindy with us, but Lindy and Jessica recently went to Sydney, and I might get you to explain about that whole trip.
Yeah, we recently, Lindy Brody, an artist with the Tardukula Mob, and I travelled to Sydney because Lindy and Susanna had work selected for a group show in Darlington that was curated by Peter Fay. And it was a group show of seven contemporary artists from across Australia. So Lindy and I thought we better go and represent. And we went over and spent a day looking at all different art galleries around Melbourne before we went to the exhibition.
Mm-hmm.
And being there, Lindy was able to explain to all the other artists and the audience about where Tennant Creek is and what her work's about to sort of give it a bit of context, especially since we're showing in a city environment.
Mm.
Yeah, it's great.
Yeah. And you also met Ken Dome, didn't you? That was a highlight.
Yeah, that's great.
So what we will do, we're actually going to show you now a bit of a slideshow about so you can actually see some of the visual artists' work as well, to give you an idea of the breadth of stuff that they do out in the community.
Thank you.
And you're listening to ACCC 102.1 FM. I'm Stuart Liddell, and today we have Kathy Burns from the Barkley Regional Arts. She's the director, and we're actually in the midst of a live webcast called exStreamheArt. This is a partnership event with the National Rural Health Alliance for Anti-Poverty Week. Hello, Kathy, and hello to all our viewers at home tuning in for the stream. Welcome.
Thank you, Stu. So can you give us a briefly, what is ACCC Radio?
Well, ACCC is a community radio station. We broadcast from Alice Springs and now Tennant Creek. The station is revamped, we're ready to go. And I'm the station coordinator here in Tennant Creek, and I'll be bringing the ACCC voice out to the community.
And it's great to have you, because you've been around Barkley Region now back and forth for about a year, so it's nice to have someone who knows a bit about our town, so it's lovely. Why do you think it's important that Tennant Creek has its own community radio?
Well, it brings a local voice, and it allows residents to have access to communications. When people hear a local voice on the radio, they instantly generate a community spirit and are connected to something, and that is a positive thing.
Great. What range of programs and announcements can we expect to hear coming from Tennant Creek?
Well, we've got a great bunch of shows coming up. They're already on the airwaves now. We've got the What's Up Wananjikari, which has our staff from Wananjikari Music Centre. They're going to be presenting a show. They're going to be talking about all the great things that they're doing in the studio. They're musicians, they're recording artists themselves. They're also going to be talking about some great music events that are coming up. We've got Good Morning the Barkley by another local, Katima Heathcote. She's a poet and spoken word artist, and she's going to be bringing stories from the local area and interviewing guests, and they're going to be doing it through verse and spoken word, playing some great tunes as well. We've got a show from Peter Davenport, another local, called Rhythm Stick. He's bringing his blend of 60s and 70s music, a couple of yarns thrown in there as well. And of course, Kathy, we've got your show, which is a children's language program.
Yeah, it's called Binara Aku, which means listen, you mob, in the local Warramungu language. Auntie Rosemary Plummer and I will be co-hosting the show to start next year, which will hopefully also go into schools around the region. So it's a mixture of songs that Rosemary and I have been writing in language with children singing in language, and also teaching Warramungu as well to the kids too. So it'll be great.
Yeah, can't wait. That's going to be awesome. So we're also, of course, doing sponsorship announcements and community announcements. It wouldn't be a community radio station without news from the community.
That's right. And if you would like to have your own community service announcement or message coming to Tennant Creek, you can contact us and we can even get it translated into language too.
Fantastic. Thanks for coming into the studio, Kathy. You're always welcome. Now we're going to just go to a track from Rayella. This is One More Moment at a Time. And this is from the ABC Video Postcard Series. Here we go.
Dear Gago, it's been years since you left. I miss those times when we used to sit around the campfire and the stories you used to tell. It's been a while, and I miss you. All the families miss you.
It's been years since I've seen your smiling face. You have left everything to me. And I have learned everything from you. And now it's up to me and my children. So I take one moment at a time. You have left me with so much memories. So I take
one day, I'll take my kids back to Narawan and I'll tell them the stories that you used to tell me and make sure that your legacy lives on through me. Because to me, Gago, you was always my hero.
Now I'm teaching all my children what you taught me about our country and our culture, ways of life. It's been an amazing journey. We have traveled together. In this country we all call.
So until we meet again, I miss you. Love your granddaughter.
Rayella's pretty much the next big thing to come out of the Barclays, so make sure you keep your ear out for this up-and-coming group. They've been given an amazing opportunity to perform in December this year down in Melbourne and potentially Tasmania, I think, as well, at two festivals. So really amazing for a very small town like Marlinger, which is about 3.5 hours from here, to get that experience. So really great. Next we're going to talk about is our Media Mob program. And Media Mob is basically, they run everything from filming to editing to designing to photography, webcasting. They also manage our websites and all our social media. They do fee-for-service works when organisations want TV ads made or films made in the region. They come to Media Mob, and it's basically all done with a team of two people, which is quite incredible. In 2012, I came up with a training team called Media Mob, which was basically get young people engaged in media. And we started off with a number of people. We had a trainer come over and work with the fellas for 26 weeks, training of media. And one of those people was Sean Barkelly, who is joined with me. And Sean has a story about how he came to be involved in Media Mob. So I might let Sean here tell us that story. Go for it.
Yeah. Hey, everyone. Well, first, I'd like to thank everyone because this is awesome. Everyone's worked hard on it. I don't really know where to start with this story.
Well, remember when the bus came and...
I don't like telling that story. I really don't.
You do so.
So it's not the best story in the world. Because a while ago, I got expelled from school and I was doing like a lot of drinking. I passed out in the gutter and I woke up in the morning and I was actually walking up. And this bus pulled up and they asked me if I was interested in media and stuff like that. And I wasn't really too sure, but I was pretty keen to change my life and, just make a change for myself. I came, tried it out, loved it.
Yeah. And so now Sean is an employed member at Barclay Regional Arts and working in our Media Mob team. So really great outcome for someone who's stuck through that training. Yeah. And did, I mean, you've done amazingly well. You've also worked with some incredible partners. We've had Oz Opera come out here and you've been working with them. You've had links in with NITV, who are watching today, thank you. And ICTV, going to go off and work on a TV series with them. You've just had some really good opportunities. Yeah. So how is that for you?
Yeah, definitely. Like, just being in the Media Mob, it's opened more than just one door to me. It's opened so many, and I'm learning so many different skills. I actually am learning a little bit about graphic design now, and that's something I didn't think I'd be learning in the Media Mob. I thought it was just going to be cameras, but now it's really cool just learning how to use Photoshop and stuff like that.
Yeah. Well, I want to basically cut now to the documentary we made on Media Mob, which is a really good example. It shows their training schedule and their trainer, Johnson, who trained these fellas up. So let's cut to the Media Mob documentary.
The Media Mob is a program which is to engage young Indigenous people from Tennant Creek into digital media. So I was brought out here from the East Coast to facilitate the program. Basically, we've gone through everything from, you know, operating cameras to lighting to editing on high-end industry-based software. And then we've learnt practice through doing gigs. I'm from Moree, New South Wales, and I'm, I guess, what they call a half-caste. Most of the young participants that we've got are also half-caste Indigenous boys. And I see Moree as being really similar to Tennant Creek as far as remoteness, and also for me, I grew up with alcoholism and violence in my family. And from day one with these guys, you know, I could understand that they came from the same place that I came from. So the first couple of weeks, you know, I really just worked on relationships. I really worked on wanting to get to know the guys, where they're from. So my brother made a movie a few years ago. It's called Ma, which was about me and him as young people and the violence that we grew up in. So, you know, I showed the guys that the second day that we were here, and they're like, oh, far out, you know, you've really sort of, you know, been through that stuff. And I also showed them that to show them there's a way to get out, to express yourself through film. And that film really was able to, for me, it was really freeing in who I am and helped me understand a little bit more what I'd went through as a young person. So I think, you know, that was mostly one of the things that we related over, where they could just clearly see that, well, you know, he's just not some facilitator trying to come in and teach out of a textbook.
I guess I just kept kind of like sinking, really, like just in my own emotions, pretty much, like just, I don't know, I wouldn't really let myself do anything, like, I wouldn't let myself achieve anything because I didn't think I was worth it. And I stopped going to school and just thought, what's the point? Thought I was worth nothing. I think my mum had a bit to do with it, just getting drunk and then telling me stuff, and me just starting to believe it, really. Yeah. There's Sean Barkelly, he works for Media Mob too. I don't know, he's just pretty much been there since I moved here. He's like had my back since the start, pretty much, so he's like one of those blokes that would die for you.
I was a pretty weird kid, like I was alone a lot, didn't have a lot of friends. I just always looked at the world differently.
I think I started talking around about when I was 6 or 7.
I didn't know English, I didn't know language. I was mute for a while. My mum would always used to sit me down in front of movies and I'd get most of my English off of movies. So I guess it was a good thing watching a lot of movies.
When I was a kid, nobody ever said, oh, when you grow up, you can be whatever you want, or no one ever asked me, what do you want to be? So school just never interested me. Nothing really did. Didn't want anything. Nothing was for me. But now I'm starting to get older, I'm more mature. I now have goals and places I want to be. I'm better off how I am now than I was 2 years ago.
Well, when I was a teenager, I actually was looking at prison most of my time, so I stole a car, broken into a few houses, destroyed a few houses. Basically ran amok when I was a little boy. He wasn't a good father at first, and now he is. We had our ups and downs. Got welfare, went to welfare, got taken away for about a year almost, about 6 months max. I went with Fiona and Michelle Franken. They took me away for a bit, looked after us until Dad got out of jail, come picked us up, took us back here. From then onwards, it's been good. I knew Jackson for a while and then known Sean for a while. They're good people to know, to hang out with. Used to hang out with Sean in the creek. All these young fellas playing around in the creek. Jackson, same thing, but now I'm about 20. I've got offered this job with the media mob and I took it. I thought it might be something different for my life. And they basically created a goal set for me. So I'm starting to enjoy what I'm doing now and can't go wrong. I had to be up before 7:30, had to be always ready for work, have to get there on time. I had to make sure, you know, I'm reliable, prove my point, show people that I can do what I can do, show what I can do.
You really need those supportive people in your life. Nobody's really taken time for me, like, to teach me anything really, so just him teaching me that kind of raised my spirits a lot. I guess it just showed that somebody really cared.
In the classroom, there's quite a good bit of banter between myself and the boys, as far as they usually put a fair bit of crap on me and tease me quite hard. And, you know, our behaviour is a little bit loose and, you know, we like to have a bit of fun in the classroom, but we get through so much by doing that and breaking down that, you know, this is a classroom and you have to be rigid and rah, rah, rah. We just have a lot of fun in the classroom. But as soon as these boys step out onto any gig, like, it amazes me how much they just, you know, they sit up, you know, their heads come up, they're proud, you know, they're on show in the community, they're these guys setting up the cameras, you know what I mean? We've got the Mad Media Mob shirts, the Mad Media Mob jackets. When they put on that uniform, I can see a change that comes over them. It's like, all right, you know, we're game on now, you know, professionalism just comes through. And I think, you know, it's a great idea, you know, to have uniforms for them, because it does make us a team, it does bond us together, it does show the community, hey, these aren't just a bunch of rat bag kids, you know what I mean? These guys are professional camera operators, professional media mob.
We're all a crew now, like, we're very well acquainted, we are a crew, we operate, we work, we sleep, we eat together and travel around together, and it's nothing but a good time.
The media mob have been getting a great reputation, not only around Tennant Creek, but around the Northern Territory. So our first road trip was down to Alice Springs for Vibe 3-on-3 basketball competition.
Not too nervous, probably because, well, yeah, we've filmed stuff like this before.
And I'm pretty keen, I'm not nervous. Nothing to be nervous about.
I think the only person that's nervous right now is our conductor, Shane. And yeah, we've done stuff like this before, so we're not nervous about it at all.
A little bit nervous, it's our first big job out of Tennant Creek, but I reckon we're heaps pro, we've got everything organised.
So the road trip down was well fun, you know, like, you know, as soon as we got into the car, the boys are just pumping their screamo music and that sort of stuff, which is, you know, much to my headache.
It takes the breath out of me.
It was fun. I think the main thing that came out of it for me personally was, you know, further bonding with the boys.
We're excited for the day. The boys are meant to be up at about 6:30. It's now 6:37, so it was a big day, so we might just have to go and give them a little bit of a wake. Boys!
Oh my God, come on boys, get up. We've got to go, we're due there in 10 minutes, come on. Boys! These two doing in there together? How come you're not in your room, Sean? Come on, let's go. Let me out. The feedback that comes in about them and how professionally they were and how well, you know, not well behaved, but just how professional they're being on a gig and how proud the community is of them. And it's made me extremely proud to know that, you know, I was a part of helping getting these boys all the professionalism that would stand up on a broadcast and streamed live on the internet.
So the boys is going good. We started strong with the opening ceremony. It was nice to have that so we could just get the boys locked off in a position, get them a little bit comfortable with filming, fill the space. And then when the workshops started and the round started, I guess there was a little bit of confusion, a little bit of hustle and bustle, a bit of mixed information, and boys looked a little bit stressed for a moment, so we just sort of put the cameras down for a couple of minutes, had a bit of a regroup, a replan about what we've got to do next, and just refocus on the shots that we've got to get. All in all, they're going good. They're looking the part. Proud as punch of them.
They're skill-based as far as using cameras and editing on, you know, high-end software such as Final Cut Pro is really beyond any expectations I had on them. And then I think beyond that, there's, you know, what we've been able to work through together personally. You know, like Froggo's having a baby, you know, in the next couple of months. The baby's due in November, so we've been able to talk a lot about that sort of stuff and what my ideas of what a man is and what a man should be in that situation and what his responsibilities are.
Rochelle, I've been with her for about four years now. We're only 4 to 15 weeks pregnancy now. I looked after her, she looks after me. She's a wonderful person to have in my life, I guess. What I've seen in my time is, I hope my kid doesn't see that. I want my kid to have a good life, good parents, always have someone to be there for. I am a bit scared that I'm not going to be able to make it, but in a way I reckon I could make it and be able to step up and do something about it. Yeah, it's a bit scary.
I have seen like a bit of a change. I think it's just from meeting a lot of new people. You just gotta show some confidence, as you come off as a bit weird. Well, I guess with meeting mob, I just really feel like I've achieved something. Like just the amount we've learnt in the small amount of time, like just like it really makes you feel able. Like they do, yeah. It's looking to be pretty good. Like something I would enjoy doing for the rest of my life.
I kind of feel better knowing I'm finding that way out. Like I'm slowly crawling out of depression, but I'd rather be slowly crawling than stuck in a hole. So I'm happy with where I'm at now. It just shows like how people can come from nothing. Yeah, we're doing stuff with our life. Everyone should have somewhere they want to be. Like, I want to be an actor, get rich, famous and stuff, go somewhere I want to be, live the easy life. That's my dreams, that's where I want to be.
I guess in a sense, you know, they mean the world to me at the moment. Like, I think I've been involved in doing this sort of work for the last, you know, 6-7 years, and I think I'll look back on this time as some of my most fondest time as an artist, as a filmmaker, as a trainer, as a facilitator.
Well, if it wasn't for this course, I don't think I'll have this much confidence in myself at all. Plus, take that shameless away and get it out of you. Because that's the only thing that drops you down, makes you embarrassed, and you get all giggly and rah, and then you gotta, you know, like, come on, wake up, get over it. You'll grow up sooner or later.
It's important that our people are telling our stories. That's what my core is about with working in media, is more Aboriginal people involved in media and them telling the stories of our elders, them telling the stories of our young people, them telling the stories of country, and them telling the stories of our families.
So that was a really successful training program. And we're using that as a pilot for many other youth training programs from here on in. Because of Media Mob's success, this year they went for an ABC Haywire grant, and they are successful in getting that, in which they then created 14 amazing video postcards. But I want to jump now to our media manager, Lincoln McKinnon, who is behind the desk, so we're going behind the screen to have a chat with him. And get Lincoln, if you can, tell us all about that video postcard series.
The Haywire video postcard series was... It was set up to show the positive image of the youth in the Barkly region. Often in the media, the youth of the Barkly region get such a negative portrayal. There's, you know, lots of, you know, violence and drinking going on. But what doesn't happen is they don't show all the positive things going on. So this Haywire video postcards really showed all the great things happening around the Barkly region, people doing sporting, artistic things, music, community groups. So it was a really fantastic project and really inspiring for myself and for the Media Mob team to see all these great things happening. So I went out with the Media Mob team all around the Barkly region. You know, we were doing things like we were filming into water up to our necks when we had the intense rainfall here, filming that Eleanor Dixon video postcard. And yeah, Media Mob got to do everything from scripting to filming to doing the audio to editing and then doing things like creating the website that would go on to and doing the social media posts that go with it. So, those videos were received a lot of attention in the media, particularly through ABC, which was fantastic. But most importantly, it got a lot of media in our local community and the newspapers and Facebook pages. And it was really great to see the community really proud of what the Barkly community are doing and what Media Mob and Barkly Arts are doing. So all around, it was fantastic.
And there's the MediaMob.net website that people, if they want to see that whole series, you can watch, yeah?
Yeah. So part of the media mob training that we do is working. We've got three websites. So we've got mediamob.net.au, which has everything that Media Mob's up to. And Sean Barkelly, who we just met from Media Mob, is sort of in charge of that. So he's loading up videos, he's doing graphics. We also manage, you know, the Barkly Arts official website, barklyarts.com.au, and the Desert Harmony Festival website, which you'll hear a lot about soon in a minute from you, Kathy.
Yep.
And the training also involves a lot of other aspects, so still photography, video, audio mixing, even just general writing skills for emails, press releases, things like that. Yeah, it's quite quite broad in its scope. And at the moment, Sean's been particularly involved in graphic design in Photoshop, and he's been doing quite a marvelous job. And as you can see here, this is part of the training too. Here we've got Ben here from ICTV working with us. Jimmy Boy here doing the audio. So this is our live web streaming equipment. So it's really good to receive training in that as well.
Thanks, Lincoln. And Lincoln and Sean are absolute gems running our entire media department, which is fantastic. The other stuff that Media Mob do is also a lot of fee-for-service work. So organisations who might want to make a TV series, they might want to get some sort of community message out and they need it done locally, they'll come to Media Mob. Recently, the National Disability Insurance Agency rolled out their new scheme here in the Barkly. So they wanted a locally produced resource that they could then take out to communities to explain what that scheme was all about. So they approached us and our media unit put together a video using our local cheeky dog artist, Dion Beasley. So let's have a quick look at that beautiful NDIS video we created.
The National Disability Insurance Scheme, NDIS, is a new way of helping Australians with a disability and their families and carers. People with a disability will get supports to help them look after themselves and join in the community and culture around them. The NDIS is starting in a few different places around Australia before it goes to the country starting in 2016. The Tennant Creek area has one of the first offices to open. Dion Beasley lives in town and will be one of the first people in the Northern Territory to participate in the NDIS. Dion Beasley is well known for his cheeky dog art, clothing line and picture books, an important part of his community. He uses his electric scooter to get himself around town and to visit his family. Before this, his carer Joy had to transport him. Every afternoon, Dion drives his scooter to his granddad's place in a community living area close to Tennant Creek. He sits with his granddad and watches the different dogs that live in community. This is always an exciting part of Dion's day. The NDIS will help people like Dion to do the things that are important to them. Now Dion has a new plan, to do the food shopping on his own.
Dion and his carer Joy meet with an NDIA planner to talk about his plan and supports. Participants and their carers or guardians are involved in deciding the help they need, and the NDIA planner will make sure that each person's plan has the things that are important to them. They will check that you are under 65 years of age, that you live in the Barkly Shire, and that your disability is permanent, creating challenges to achieve everyday tasks. Once this is confirmed, your planner will help write a plan of what is important to you. The planner will then help you implement and manage your plan. The NDIA planner will continue to make sure you are receiving the right supports. For more information, speak to your local community health centre, doctor, or contact the NDIS. The local government business manager in your community can also tell you when the NDIS will be visiting your area. Phone the National Disability Insurance Scheme Tennant Creek office on 1800 800 110 or visit our office at the Indigenous Coordination Centre, 129 Patterson Street, Tennant Creek. We also produced that clip in language as well, but we thought we'd show you the English version so that you knew what was going on. The next program I want to talk to you about is our Youth Arts program. Youth Arts is a program that we've embedded now across all of our sections. So WMC have Youth Arts, Viz Arts and Media also encompass Youth Arts into their programs. For example, WMC have a youth training program where some disengaged kids from the primary school come over and the fellas teach them a whole range of music skills as well, just to get them re-engaged and interested in some skills. The big part of Youth Arts is about access for young people into professional arts training and skills and performance-based. So we have artists that come in and work in Tennant Creek, and we also send them out on community so that the community schools also have access to it as well. It's also really important that young people know that arts can be a career for them. When it's so distant and if you've had no experience, you don't get access to it, then it's the last thing that you think about. Your career choices could be working at the shop or being a nurse or things that you see physically in your space. So what we've been working hard on is making sure that people understand that arts can be a really good career. Also really important is that the young people are the next generation who are going to be stepping up and telling their community stories, and most ways that community stories are told are through art. So if there's no one trained in visual arts, no one's trained in media, no one's trained in the basics of music, then those stories will just get lost as well. So that's a really part of having access to. We work a lot in partnerships with different arts organisations, so we bring specialised skills over. So outside of what we do here, for example, we've had NASDA, which is a dance academy in New South Wales, we've had working with us for this year. They've been sending two artists out, a male and a female, which is also really important when we're working with young people, that we have someone from each gender to make sure that everyone is involved and feels comfortable working with the artists. So Janita and Kyle from NASDA have come out since May this year working with the students and teaching a mixture of like Indigenous traditional dance plus contemporary dance as well. And we work towards creating a huge interactive show this year for the Desert Harmony Festival called Deadly Dancing, in that they taught communities a whole range of music, plus and they went on stage and they taught them those dances to the audience, and it was a really great experience. The kids really shone through, and it was just great to see some of those kids who can be really shame come to life through dancing and find a really great expression through dance, and I know all their teachers were snapping away madly, taking great photographs, watching them on stage. It was really beautiful to see them just come alive. Another really successful program that we had, similar to Media Mob, in that we did long-term training, it was called Lady Beats. Males in Barkly region get a lot of attention in music. There's a lot of training that happens for males in music and not so much with females. So a way of addressing that was creating a specific program which was just focusing on re-engaging females, young females, and giving them skills in music. So everything from songwriting to recording to performing and producing music as well. So we've been working with an artist for a long time called Queen G from Sydney. She's been coming out for many years with us, building a really great relationship with the young women here in the community. So we brought her out, and she spent a long time with the girls creating songs, and Media Mob actually made one of their first film clips. It was called Wannabe, and we want to show you that film clip now.
is the power, power from within. Speak for our rights, come on, let's begin. Our past, our present, our future is what we have to build. Together, let's hold up the shield of life. Celebrate, make no mistake, take away the heartache. Replace with love, send it above. Be free as a dove, lift the spirits up. Resurrect the ancestors, embrace the life within. That's who we be, the land is ours. We've been here for hours, never cowards. Proud, original, aboriginal. Forever we stand on the red land.
Where the rain hits the sand, let's join hands. Do the culture dance, paint up our bodies. Our beauty is unmatched, red, yellow, black. This is where we're at.
The choice is yours to be free, be what you wanna be. Freedom is your destiny, be who you wanna be. The choice is yours to be free, be what you wanna be. Freedom is your destiny, be who you wanna be. If you wanna be free, follow me to the river that flows free.
Your wings feel the wind, sing with the words. Standing on the land, touch down with the sound. Hear the heartbeat from the center. See the red rock as you enter. Recognize respect when the sun set. The colors that you see will let you be free. My people, we hold the key to be what we wanna be.
The choice is yours to be free, be what you wanna be. Freedom is your destiny, be who you wanna be. The choice is yours.
That video clip actually also won the National Remote Indigenous Media Festival Award last year, so really good things that were coming out. We've made a whole documentary about Lady Beats Training. It's a FACSIA-funded program, so you can also go onto our sites and view that video as well to learn more about them. So Youth Arts is moving towards a direction which we call Art School in Residence. We're hoping to achieve full-time artists placed in the Barkly region to be able to deliver professional arts training for young people, so that's kind of the future for our Youth Arts. We've only got two more programs that we're going to talk about. The next one is our touring and events program. Basically, we do about 15 events a year. That's kind of a minimum. We sometimes do more. And we also work on a lot of people's other organisations' events as well. It could be anything just from doing a rally to putting on a big music event or setting just some cameras up and doing some documenting. We also take on our artists on tour. This year, WMC went on a tour called Gone Bush. They'd just finished producing their latest CD, so we wanted to take that around to the different communities to show everyone. Plus, we also spent that time with our mobile recording unit recording all those different communities then as well, which is now being mixed and mastered and being built into a big community album as we speak. We bring about 6 to 10 touring acts into the Barkly, so that way then, being so remote, people aren't disadvantaged by not seeing the latest sort of work that's going on that the rest of Australia gets to see. The biggest development that we've had with our touring productions is that we now ensure that the touring acts don't just come into Tennant Creek, do a nice big show and then leave. We make sure that they collaborate with our community at the same time. Often it's really hard to try and get people to come along and see the shows, particularly when you don't know who they are. It's very hard to sell that. So a big part is that we try and engage the community in some form. It could be through a workshop, but most times we try and push towards having them involved in some level of the show. The greatest example of that, Oz Opera come, and they've been coming to Tennant Creek for quite a while now. They brought Don Giovanni last year. And of course they wanted a lot of people to come to the opera. So how, you know, do you get people interested in opera that's, you know, it's a little bit far removed, I suppose, out here. So we did three things. We put together 3 points for Oz Opera. One, was that if they could actually reduce the ticket price and give away a number of free tickets to people who are disadvantaged, so people with disability, the elderly and young people. And we had a number of free tickets that were given away so people could actually have access to the show, first of all. The second thing we did was that we wanted to webcast the show. We didn't promote it because obviously they're on a national tour and we didn't want everyone seeing what that show was, so we kept it closed. But what we did, we got our remote community set up, and often the schools took care of that. They set up a projector screen and they invited the community to come in and actually watch the opera in community, which was really great. And Medium Mob were employed for that. They're all on the cameras, and that was a really great big production there. The third and the most important aspect that we put into that was that we got WMC to do all the pre-show. Now, it wasn't just the fellas getting up there and doing their own music and then the show started. The fellas did a solo performance and their songs were completely backed by the Oz Opera Orchestra. And it was really, really beautiful. They came and spent pretty much a day doing rehearsals with WMC. And then that night they performed. And being in that audience space, it was really, really touching to hear their music with an orchestra backing them up. It was really quite beautiful. So we want to show you a little bit of a clip. This is Marcus Finlay working with the Oz Opera Orchestra.
Good evening, all. This next song we're going to sing is one of our own originals. This one is called On the Other Side.
That was a really beautiful collaboration, and it's hard sometimes to get that across on film, but it was really phenomenal sitting and listening to that. And our relationship with Oz Opera is continuing. They're bringing the Magic Flute next year, and we're looking at having a Barclay choir, so they'll be embedded right throughout the show for next year, so that'll be pretty special. Our last program that I'm going to talk to you about is our Desert Harmony Festival. It's massive, and it's been running for 25 years. We took it over in 2009, so Barclay Regional Arts have been hosting it since 2009. And this year was the 25th anniversary. So we've built the festival from a 3-day festival into a 10-day festival. This year we had 25 years celebrating the Barclays history of innovation, so it went for 17 days. We had 31 events in that, so it was mammoth. And the festival is BRA's major showcase platform. It shows off all the talent of the Barclay through professional events. For example, the Wenatchee Music Centre have their big day, which is called BAMFest, Barclay Artist Music Festival. Viz Arts put on a huge arts cultural experience day. Youth Arts do a massive youth arts night, which this year they did the Deadly Dancing, that interactive dance show. And media often show up their latest film, and of course they webcast all the events, and WMC run all the production for the entire festival as well. So it's a really big professional platform for us to put together all our training that we've done throughout the year and show it off into a national and international audience who tune in for the webcasting of those events. And really important, the webcasting, how we came about webcasting was basically from the Desert Harmony Festival. We can't expect that everyone from the Barclay region can make their way into Tennant Creek to see it. And often, you know, friends and family are performing in the show, so the webcasting was about putting up screens out in community so people could tune in and watch their friends and family from afar. And that's been really successful. We have artists that come in and work with the community on arts projects. This year we had stencil artist Reagan Temanui, and we did a banner project. So we created 25 banners from 25 different organisations in the community that were stencilled, and they hung all in the main street. And we also had sculptural artist Mandy Francis come in primary school for an artist in residence grant creating 3D sculptures, which was really amazing. We had a Festival Hub design team, the Village Festival, that came up this year and created our beautiful Festival Hub space. And we employed people locally in town to come and build that space. And we also had the NASDA dance artists work right out in community with all those children, teaching them dance, and brought that in as well. We also have a number of touring acts that we get each year. We had Deadly Funny Comedy Roadshow this year, which was really great to have a professional comedy show. And we had the beautiful Seychelles Islander singer Grace Barbe entertain us for our gala dinner night. The festival, we also encompass things like speedway, little athletics, and last year we also webcast the sport. We have a street parade where people all decorate their floats. We do circus, we have art awards, art exhibitions, art markets, multicultural dinner nights, open mic events, cabaret nights, fringe band events, and film nights. So it's really quite a big festival for Tennant Creek, and the reason we go to such extremes is that it's Tennant Creek. We don't often get a lot of productions. We don't get really high-end stuff, so we try and celebrate it as much as we can, and we promote our artists and give them a platform which to show what's been happening in very remote communities and the talent that goes on here and how absolutely incredible that is, and share our culture with the rest of Australia and the world as well. So it's really important. And some other great initiatives that have come about, we've had the students from the National Rural Health coming for the last 2 years. Obviously they want to learn about issues that are happening in communities. So they come out each year and they sit up at one of the festival events and do a stall, and it's quite interactive. They'll wrap kids in bandages and make slinky apples, and it's been a really great partnership. And we've also had that with Griffith University as well. People have been coming out for the last 5 years, sending music students out. And they volunteer, they learn from the Wenatchee Music Centre, they write songs together, they perform together, and they volunteer on the whole production. And it's been a really beautiful collaboration. So, the Desert Harmony Festival is our big number, and it happens right smack bang in the middle of the year. So we're kind of still recovering from the end of that, which was the end of August this year too. So, you can read more about our festival. You can go to our website, desertharmonyfestival.com, and see more and take in more content from this year. So that's basically Barclay Regional Arts. That's our 7 different programs that we've been able to take you through. We've been checking on Twitter and pretty much had some really great shout outs, but I can't see a lot of questions unless any other questions have come in, or if anyone can think of anything. And again, you're more than welcome to keep emailing us if something arises and you think about maybe later on that you might want to ask us. We're always happy to answer questions. And again, we've just shown you snippets of a lot of content. So again, please go through to our Barclay Arts websites, our Media Mob websites, our festival websites, our Vimeo, and go and take in all the content that we've done, because we produce quite a fair bit. Keeps us really, really busy and on our toes. So, yeah. That's it pretty much for today. Thank you so much for tuning in to Extreme Heart. Big thank you to our partners, the National Rural Health, for inviting us to do this. So it's really great to be able to share what we do out in little old Tennant Creek here in the Barkly region with the rest of you. And have a really great day. Thank you.
It's about a place called Large Bluff, Ikunji. Yeah, we came a long way. Well, yeah, thank you for having us. Once again, thank you to Tennant Creek, especially Warramunga people. Up in your hand. Clap. Come on. Come on. Tennant Creek. Hey.